Okay, a very good evening to all brothers and sisters in the Dhamma. So today is also another auspicious day, 5th of November 2020, Thursday class, because we are going to start a new series of sharing. We are going to base it on this sutta, the sutta of infinite or innumerable meaning. Wu Liang Yi Jing is a very, very powerful Mahayana Sutta. I will explain to you all later when I start. So for those who miss this sharing, you have to listen to it again. Otherwise, you cannot understand how this sutta come about and the deep meaning behind this sutta. Then how to locate the place it fit in into the Mahayana Sutta. This sutta is one of the book within the threefold Lotus Sutta. I will give you the full explanation later. You don't have to copy notes. I already given Sui the notes. Then she also had the link. The link that I sent to my Kayamita. After you can on the link, if you cannot read it on your handphone, if it's too small, then you open the link, it's very clear. Then if you want the detail, you click on the title, like virtue, you click on the title, the whole thing come out. So this is how we can do the sharing. Just relax body and mind, be at ease. Then we shall prepare ourselves for meditation. So this meditation can be done in any posture. Whatever posture that you are comfortable with, that you are able to stable your physical body. It can be in the cross-legged, sitting on the cushion or floor. Or you can also sit on a chair or lean against a wall or a chair. Maintain awareness. Relax, maintain awareness. Don't fall asleep. If you are very tired, you need to sleep. You also can rest. But as you rest, if your awareness can be maintained, you maintain. It cannot, you can sleep. No problem. Then after that, you will recuperate very fast. If you know how to meditate and rest, you recuperate very fast. Then later on, learn to develop the meditation. You can also do it in a lying down posture. Well, lying down posture is very good. It has the least resistance. You don't cross your leg. There is no restriction anywhere. Then your entire body and mind can be very relaxed. So whatever posture that is suitable, that can give rise to the condition for you to stabilize your physical body so that you can relax and maintain awareness to develop the meditation. If it's cross-legged, you must learn how to relax into it. Otherwise, the chi flow will be affected at the place you cross your leg. Yeah, there's a constriction there. Then there are certain reasons why people cross like, these are people who likes to develop jhana, concentration, energy field. When you cross like, you force your energy to go up. So all this is what other people do, but ours is awareness-based meditation. So we try not to do that. But if you are used to the cross-legged sitting posture, it's up to you. As long as you know how to relax and maintain awareness, you can also be in that posture. I'll give you off the light so that you can have a half an hour of formal awareness-based meditation. Always remember the first three of the four support. Just relax, maintain awareness, and silence your mind for as long as you can. the maintenance of awareness is very important. Yeah, the awareness nature is your true mind, your silent mind. You need to stabilize that. When you are in that with that awareness, you cannot have thought. There is no thinking. It's just aware. There is the free mind, the true mind. But not everybody has the spiritual faculty to counter the mental hindrance. That's why I realize most people cannot meditate. When they try to meditate, a lot of thought arise, a lot of thinking arise, heedless thinking, born of mental hindrance that hinders your mind from entering the meditative state. So what you need to do is just to relax into it and maintain awareness. Okay? Always remember, relax, completely relax body and mind. Be at ease. And allow the mind to settle down and maintain awareness. Aware means no thought, just aware. Finish. Aware, finish. Because your consciousness is trapped inside the physical body. So it can actually give rise to contact, especially tactile consciousness. Sometimes it's hearing. The moment you perceive the hearing, finish. No need to think further. That's why aware, finish. Perceive, finish. Maybe smell, taste, tactile, or thought process. Even the hearing and the seeing also same. Just aware, silent. Aware, silent. Then relax. And if you got any object of meditation, like anapanasati or what, you can go to your breathing. You can develop the training until the anapanasati become very stable, until it transform, until subtle breathing. And the purpose of this training is to stabilize your sati so that the mind enters sati on its own. It must be a free mind. Okay, so you can continue your meditation. When the alarm trigger, I will ring the bell 3 times. Upon hearing the bell, slowly, mindfully, come out of the meditation. Then try to maintain whatever inner peace, inner calmness, and inner awareness that you have developed. Then whatever movement and action, develop the awareness, kayanupasana, so that you can stabilize your daily mindfulness and listen attentively. When you live life, maintain awareness from within. From within, you aware out. Then you will progress and you will develop the understanding very fast. Okay. Tonight is very special, and rather auspicious, like I said. It's a Thursday class, 5th of November 2020. It's a new session. We are going to share this this particular sutta based on the book, Wu Liang Yi Jing. The sutta of infinite or innumerable meaning. So it's a Mahayana sutta, it's a very famous sutta. This particular sutta, you must listen attentively so that you can understand the profound cultivation and teachings of Sakyamuni Buddha and all the other Sammasambuddha. Here, the title, as it shows, Sutta of Infinite or Innumerable Meaning, because the teaching, the sutta, as taught by Sakyamuni Buddha, is infinite. The meaning is very deep and unending, infinite meaning. And this is a very complete teaching. This is only one of the books within the threefold lotus sutta. You can see and read the whiteboard. You can follow us. I will just mark it down for you. So this is the threefold lotus sutta. Fa Hua San Pu Jing is a Mahayana sutta. So within this threefold lotus sutta, I think this is the highest teaching of Mahayana. It's all about the Bodhisattva way, the cultivation and perfection to realize Sama Sambuddhahood. And the Buddha introduced this teaching because of its deep meaning and special, very special position within the whole teaching. They call it the Threefold Lotus Sutta because there are three books in one. And these three books are very, very important and very, very powerful teachings. The first book is what we are going to study, or together we will go through. We will be basing it on the book, the essence of infinite meaning. Teachings on the adapted verses of the Sutra of Infinite or Innumerable Meaning by Zhen Yan Fa Si, the Abbot of Ciji. So the first book is this book that we are going to study, Sutra of Infinite or Innumerable Meaning. The Mandarin equivalent is Wu Liang Yi Jing. The meaning is the same, infinite meaning, Wu Liang Yi Jing. There are three chapters inside this Wu Liang Yi Jing. Chapter one is virtue. This virtue are very, very special virtue, virtue of great beings. Excuse me. Virtue of Sammasambuddhas. They are very, very special. And the chapter one's emphasis on virtue is for cultivator to understand. When you develop the cultivation, you develop wisdom. Without wisdom, there is no virtue. And this type of virtue are very unique virtue. It's not the normal common virtue of a virtuous person, no. This one come with all the understanding, the teachings, the perfection and all those things. Otherwise, you cannot manifest as a great being doing the work of the great Bodhisattva, the work of the Sama Sambuddha, to liberate and teach living beings and take them all across. So this chapter, I will go through with you later on. The Wikipedia has a very good write-up. I send it out for sharing the link. You go to your Maikayamita or the silent group or the Cameron Highland Yogi group. They are all there. After so I go through with you, you can get ready if you want to. Then chapter two is on the proclamation of the teaching. But in this text, they use the other word. They use preaching. So I changed the word because preaching sounds like another religion. Like you preach Christianity and all those things. So the teaching is not to really preach is a proclamation by the enlightened beings, by Sama Sambuddha, by Sakyamuni Buddha. So proclamation of the teaching. And this part also is explained in very deep detail of what this proclamation is all about. It's not ordinary teaching, like knowledge rattling from the text and sutta. No. It's a real proclamation. Then chapter 3, there is this 10 merits. These 10 merits also are very unique teaching. Well, the purpose of cultivating this teaching or this understanding of this book or sutta is to develop wisdom leading to virtue. And virtue is the source for merits. And this type of merits are very powerful merits. It's not just ordinary 10 meritorious action. No, these are like special merits that are cultivated based on deep understanding, based on very deep perfection over a long period of cultivation. Then with this type of merits, you can help living beings. You can invoke power of merits. You can do a lot of things. In Thai tribulation, just like our Bodhisattva vow, that chanting card, you can invoke them. That's why we need to cultivate all this. Then the second book is also a very important book. We call it the Lotus Sutta, but the Mandarin equivalent is a better description. Miao Hua Lian Hua Jing. Lian Hua is lotus, Jing is sutta. So Lotus Sutta, but Miao Hua is wonderful Dhamma. So it's the wonderful Dhamma, Lotus Sutta. This Miao Hua Lian Hua Jing or Lotus Sutta is a very special sutta. In this sutta, the Buddha has, I think if I'm not mistaken, about 20 over chapters, about 28 or I can't really remember. And inside all these chapters, he shared a lot of very good teaching, even predictions of a lot of his disciples, Sakyamuni Buddha's disciple, who finally become Sammasambuddha too in the distant future. And this sutta taught us a lot of skillful means and understanding. So this sutta is a very long sutta. That's why it's called Miao Fa, Wonderful Dhamma, Lotus Sutta. Then the final one, the last one, is also important because it's about meditation. So it's the Meditation Sutta of Samantabhara Bodhisattva, or some call it Samantabhara Bodhisattva's Meditation Sutta, Pu Xian Jing. So these three books or sutta forms the threefold Lotus Sutta. And Mahayana call it Huayan Sanpu Jing. Yes, like Huayan Jing is a very, very powerful teaching. And this one is all about the Bodhisattva way, perfecting yourself to Buddhahood. That's why it's called Huayan Jing. So a lot of Mahayana teachers or master, they cultivate this final threefold Lotus Sutta, Huayan Jing. From Huayan Jing, they develop deep understanding and penetration of truth. Then some, they move on to the Pure Land chanting, Pure Land teaching. After they have gone through all this, they realize affinity with Amitabha Buddha is very important. The Pure Land teaching, the Amitabha Buddha's Pure Land teaching, and the 48 great vows, you must create affinity with them. So finally, it seems you are familiar with Mahayana. A lot of the Mahayana great teachers or Zen master, they end up cultivating the Pure Land teaching. They just recite Amitabha Buddha. But within the Pure Land teaching, there are a lot of very beautiful teaching. This Sutta of Infinite or Innumerable Meaning is also part of the Pure Land teaching, Wuliang Yi Jing, and they have another very powerful Sutta of Amitabha, Wuliang Shou Jing. That one is Sutra of Infinite Life. Then it seems they have this understanding. If you do the Pure Land cultivation and chanting, you cultivate great affinity with Amitabha Buddha's nature and make use of his great vow to help you to cut short your training and to develop the cultivation in a more conducive way. Because when you have this affinity with Amitabha Buddha through chanting his four hao or his name, then it links you to the what they call great vows of Amitabha Buddha. Then you can take birth in the pure land developed by Amitabha Buddha's great vow. And from there, you cultivate. According to them, it's a lot easier. But it's up to you. It has to depend on the individual's affinity. If you have cultivated pure land before, if you have affinity with Amitabha, you will also be able to do it. Yeah. But for me, my nature, I also been through all this. Yeah. That's why I have affinity with Amitabha Buddha too. When I first heard this chanting, especially Amitabha Buddha, Amitabha, 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 my nature just rose and it can just follow. Then even Kuan Yin Bodhisattva is the same. The mantra of great beings, especially Amitabha and Kuan Yin. But then finally, my cultivation is on the truth, the teachings, the Dhamma, because I realize that one is more important. When you have the teaching, that is the basis of all, basis of virtue, basis of merits, basis of wisdom, and all the perfection, and you have developed them, you become different. You become very, very different and very beautiful. So hopefully with this introduction, you can understand where this book, Wuliang Yi Jing, or Sutra of Infinite or Innumerable Meaning, fit into the Mahayana teaching. Then I will now go to Wikipedia, the link that I sent to you all, and use that to guide you and that you understand. So this is the Innumerable Meaning Sutra, or Sutra of Innumerable Meaning. So according to Wikipedia, the description here is very complete and is very good. The Innumerable Meaning Sutra, or Sutra of Innumerable Meaning, or Infinite Meaning, is also known as the Sutra of Infinite Meaning. So this two is the same. In Sanskrit, it's called Ananta Nadisa Sutra. Then in traditional Chinese or Mandarin, under Pinyin, Wuliang Yi Jing. You know to read Mandarin, you can read that, right? Otherwise, the Pinyin is there. Wuliang Yi Jing. Japanese, no need to know. Maybe I ask my daughter to read Japanese. Ni bu hui pronounce. Moyogi kyo. Yeah, read.
Moyogi kyo. Ryo is meaning. Ryo is
Infinite meaning.
Real is the quantity. Ki is meaning. Yeah. Kyo is sutra.
Mu is infinite.
Mu is like infinite.
Kyo is sutra. Yeah, correct. Then in Korean is Woyang Gui Gyon. It's a Mahayana Buddhist text. According to tradition, it is translated from the Sanskrit into Chinese by Dhamma Jatayasa, an Indian monk in the year 481 AD. However, Baswell, Dios and Muller describe it as an apocryphal Chinese text. I also don't know how to pronounce that word. Never mind. It is part of the Threefold Lotus Sutta. Here he explained too, along with the Lotus Sutta and the Samantara Bhadra Meditation Sutta. So these are the other two books, along with the Miao Fa Lian Hua Jing, the wonderful Dhamma Lotus Sutta and the Meditation Sutta by Samantara Bhadra Bodhisattva. As such, many Mahayana Buddhists consider it as the prologue or introduction to the Lotus Sutta. The Lotus Sutta is the second book, Miao Fa Lian Hua Jing. And chapter one of the Lotus Sutta states that the Buddha taught this infinite meaning sutta just before the expounding or proclamation of the Lotus Sutta. The Bodhisattvas are thus called Mahasattva. These are great beings, great Bodhisattva, Mahasattva, like Guan Yin, Pu Xian, Wen Su, Di Chang Wang Pusa, even those Sifang San Sen, Manjushri, Wen Su, Da Si Si, all these are Mahasattva. So the Bodhisattva are thus called Mahasattvas in the Threefold Lotus Sutta, Huayan Sanpu Jing, because they have a great goal of obtaining supreme enlightenment, Bohi, and finally attaining Buddhahood by enlightening all beings. So this is the purpose of the Threefold Lotus Sutta. Their great goal is to obtain this supreme enlightenment, supreme Bohi, and finally attain Sammasambuddhahood. Then you go and develop the vow to enlighten all beings. This chapter is called Virtue simply because all the beings in the assembly, no matter what state they were in, desire to praise the Buddha for his virtue, his precepts, his meditation wisdom, emancipation, and knowledge of emancipation. So all these are very complete. He not only understands the perfections of precepts and virtue, he also understands Prajna Paramita, means perfection of wisdom, all of the meditation, then the emancipation, how they liberate their mind and awaken, and the knowledge of emancipation and excellence. So all this are the unique quality of the Buddha.
Correction.
Fa Hua, sorry. Yeah, my daughter corrected me. Yeah, Fa Hua, correct. Not Hua Yan, sorry. Fa Hua Sambuji. Correct. Sorry. The Threefold Lotus Sutta is Fa Hua Sanpu Jing. Okay. The Huayan Jing is Avantasaka Sutta. Sorry. That one is another sutta. That one is Huayan Jing. But this one is Fa Hua Jing. Sorry, huh? Thank you for the correction. Huh? So make a note of that. In doing so, they could sow their knowledge of the Buddha deep into their mind. That's why this one, you must plant the seed of Bodhi deep into your nature. Then after that, we move on to the second chapter. The second chapter is here, they use the title preaching. Here they follow the translation. It should be proclamation of his teaching. Eh? In this chapter, the Buddha addressed the great adornment Bodhisattva and other 80,000 Bodhisattvas in the assembly and explained to them that this sutta makes unawakened Bodhisattva accomplish perfect enlightenment quickly. See, unawakened Bodhisattva means you haven't fully enlightened. You may have your enlightenment, the early stages of sainthood, arahant shape. You may have started taking your Bodhisattva vow and continue the cultivation, but you haven't perfected yourself. So this sutta explain and enable the unawakened Bodhisattvas to accomplish perfect enlightenment quickly. The word quickly is inverted comma, means relatively is quite fast. If a Bodhisattva wants to learn and master this doctrine of innumerable meaning, he should observe, this one is very important. This is the Buddhist wisdom or understanding that I have been teaching you all. You must understand this. Otherwise, you cannot understand the Sutta of Infinite Meaning. So I read again. If a Bodhisattva wants to learn and master this teaching or doctrine of innumerable meaning sutta, he should observe that all phenomena were originally, will be, and are in themselves void in nature. So this void is emptiness, cold. And form, they are neither great nor small, neither appearing nor disappearing, neither fixed nor movable, and neither advancing nor retreating, and they are non-dualistic, just emptiness, cold. Where this is the unconditioned. That's why no duality, nothing. So this principle of void or emptiness, empty nature or existence, Kong Si, is very powerful. It has deep meaning. That's why in the Heart Sutta is mentioned, in true emptiness, when you realize true emptiness in the unconditioned, that the conditioned world become wonderful existence. Zhen Kong Miao Yu. So emptiness has two deep meaning. The first is the realization of true emptiness, the unconditioned, within our nature, where our nature is Zuzu Putong, the true nature, original nature, the oneness nature, and the awareness nature, the oneness nature is beyond words, beyond thought, beyond condition. But when you take birth, or when you need to come to the existential world to live life, then you have to understand the other aspect of emptiness based on the teaching of Sakyamuni Buddha, the three universal characteristics of anicchang, dukkang, and anatta, especially anatta. Anatta, the meaning is very deep. It's neither at Atta or Attaniya. Atta is the other extreme, the duality, means self, a permanent unchanging entity that you can hold on to, cling on to, grasp on to, and say, this is me, this is I, is not subject to suffering. Even tends towards suffering is eternal, right? But no, your form and mind is not eternal, right? So you have to understand the phenomenal world is a world of consciousness. It has its universal characteristics of impermanent. You attach and cling one thing your way, it leads to suffering. Then because it's impermanent, it's not a permanent and changing entity, you cannot grasp, you cannot cling. That is also not atanya. Atanya means no self, no permanent self, means empty, nothing, nothingness. No, the Buddha says it's not nothingness. That form and mind, the segmented life that we take karmically conditioned out for us to come to the existential world, to live life, to experience life, to go through karma, to cultivate, to perfect ourselves, and to repay whatever karmic conditioning and fulfill our vow, etc. That one exists. That one is as real as can be within the conditioned world. But it's subject to karma. It's subject to the law of nature within the conditioned world. That's why that aspect of wisdom is very important. Then when you insight into phenomena, awaken and develop the deep understanding of the unconditioned, then you will come to know what anatta means, what the Buddha meant by anatta. Anatta is in between. The middle way, the middle path, neither atta or ataniya. It's not complete self and no self. It's not nothingness. It has thing, but that one is not a permanent and changing entity. It's not a self. So this is a very beautiful understanding. So there is something, but not self. That's why they call it non-self. It's not a permanent unchanging entity, self, that you can cling on to, hold on to. Yeah. That's why it's called non-self. Then the other deep meaning is empty nature of existence, where everything is conditioned, arising, dependent, originating. So when it is dependent originating condition arising, that's why it has the universal characteristics of impermanent. Dependent on condition, it arises. Dependent on condition, it sustains itself and continues to manifest. And when condition ceases to be, it ceases to be. That's why it's impermanent. So you will understand this. Then because it's impermanent, it is not real. Not a permanent unchanging entity. It's not you. It's non-self. It's not self. Then you realize everything within the conditioned world, although it has its own reality, but in the ultimate sense, when you realize true emptiness from the unconditioned, you realize everything is not what you think. Empty nature existence. No reality. Whatever you may experience or go through over the countless eons and eons and eons of birth and death. Finally, I ask you, is there any reality? Is each and every segment of the life really you? Even if we take this life, we cannot deny we were born into this world through our mother's womb. And we live that life until now. Is it real? As real it can be. It's already there and gone. Do you understand? The moment you are born, that moment is a split moment. That as you grew up, evolve and become what you are today. Moment by moment, life passes by. And they are all dependent originating condition arising cause of or not. So ultimately, You can only recall to memory what happened. As long as the human mind can recall you exist, like your friends, your parents, or people who knows you, then maybe in their mind they hold on. But how real is that mundane consciousness and thinking? That's a no reality. Empty. Empty nature existence. You come, you go. When your dependent originating or condition arising condition, the three conditions that sustain your life cease. Your identity cease. Or we call erase. You're gone. Then who are you? What are you? You are nothing. It's like nothing has happened. Like our famous Mandarin song, 往事只能回味. You can only recall the past. There is no reality at all. Yeah, you can talk about it. You cannot deny you exist. So what? When your breath stops, your identity erased. Ultimately, it's empty. That's why the profound meaning that when I heard this saying in the early days when I was very young, they say, 来也空,去也空. Means when you come to this world, when you are born into this world, you came empty, empty-handed. Then when you die, you cease from this existence, you also return empty. That's why 来也空. The coming is emptiness. The going is emptiness. Then in between, why do you grieve over emptiness? Grief and toil over emptiness. 来也空,去也空. 那么施主啊,何必苦苦啊,为空流泪. Grief over emptiness in between. Because you toil, you struggle, you do all the funny things because you cannot understand life. And in between, you suffer. That's why you grieve. And according to the Buddha, the amount of tears that living beings shed is more than the four oceans in our planet. And you know our ocean, how immense is the ocean. 3/4 of Earth is covered by water. And through our tears, it can fill the four great oceans, which means you must have come and gone. Means your what they call birth and death through karmic existence, samsara. You must have arise and pass away for eternity. Means every life, let's say you cry and your tears is maybe not much, one pint, but do you know how many lives you have come? How much tears have you shed? You accumulate them all. Some cry a lot, very sorrowful, very miserable. So this understanding of the profound emptiness is very important. From the unconditioned and the conditioned, both. That's why I explained just now. There is such thing as life. Life has its own reality within the conditioned world. There is such thing as a form and mind, a being. But do not be deluded by it, deceived by it. But this one is dependent originating. Dependent originating, condition arising, causal phenomena. Not a reality, not a permanent and changing entity. So when you understand this, you make use of it. That's why there is a third phase of Dhamma called Pativeda. You get to live life to the fullest. You get to experience life to the fullest. Then you get to experience all the pristine beauties and wonders of life. That third phase of Dhamma, you get to live the life of an enlightened being when you awaken with the wisdom connected to it, Pativeda. So that is the noble life. That is the beautiful life. That's why it is very beautiful, very meaningful. So this understanding is very profound. That's the reason why my nature, when I connect back and inherit my understanding, I share this in the early days until now, today. And this one you cannot find in book. Very few people can really teach you or let you understand this deep meaning of emptiness. And to understand this type of Mahayana teaching, like the Sutra or Infinite Meaning or the Lotus Sutta, you need to have that penetrative understanding. Even the Diamond Sutta and the Surangama Sutta, they are the same. Even the Heart Sutta, it's not easy for ordinary teachers to teach or to share. Okay, with that, I will go back to the Wikipedia so that you can understand deeper. In order to realize naturally, oh, sorry, I read just now one again so that it's easier. If a bodhisattva wants to learn and master this doctrine of innumerous meaning, he should observe that all phenomena will be and are in themselves void in nature and form. They are neither great nor small, neither appearing nor disappearing, neither fixed nor movable, and neither advancing nor retreating, and they are non-dualistic, just emptiness. So this one is quite similar to the Heart Sutta, Zen Kong Miao Yu. In true emptiness, that's why he told Sariputta, there is no old age, sickness, birth and death. There is no four noble truth. There is no one to be enlightened. Then all the duality all don't exist. So if you have understood the Heart Sutta, you will understand this part. Then according to Sakyamuni Buddha, he said, in order to realize naturally, what may emerge from all laws in the future, one must first penetrate and understand this teaching deeply, this understanding of true emptiness. By realizing this, one can realize that all laws remain settled for a vast number of eons, but even after a vast amount of time, they change. That's why the universal characteristics are impermanent. Then we move on. The 10 merits. This one is very beautiful. So we have understood why the teaching come about, and teaching is for great beings to perfect themselves and share this teaching to the world, to liberate all beings. Then the 10 merits. These are the great accumulation of merits through cultivation, wisdom and perfection, and why they are important. The essence of this chapter, on the third chapter, 10 merits, is the urgent advice to master and cultivate the teaching of this sutta for the spiritual merits to be gained from it. That's why this sutta, when you understand and you are able to cultivate it and perfect it, the spiritual merits that you gain from it is exceptional. Because when you have this understanding and perfection and cultivation of this sutta, you will have the good life where it leads to the good life. The good life it leads to, and the usefulness to mankind means you can be a blessing to all in the world, all of humanity in the world, that it makes possible. Mentioned earlier in this sutta, the teaching of the Buddha are truth of the universe. That's why the universal law that governs life and nature, it is no wonder and certainly no miracle that if one lives according to the truth, his life works out well. That's why you take care of karma. Karma take care of your life. You develop the wisdom of this teaching Dhamma. You understand and comprehend perfectly all of the nature's law that governs life and existence. That's why I call it the secret of life. When you can penetrate the Four Noble Truths, the essence of the Buddha's teaching and its three turning, in its three turning, then you understand life. Because this is the secret of life, and he can summarize them into just four. Very simple but very profound noble truth. Truth that can make you noble ones or enlightened ones. So these are very beautiful teaching. Once again, the great adornment Bodhisattva is present in the assembly. Then he questioned the Buddha. He purposely questioned the Buddha about where this teaching come from, his dwelling place, and what purpose it serve. So this is for humanity to understand. The Buddha answered and said that the teaching originates in the innermost mind, our nature, of all Buddhas or Sammasambuddha. Its purpose is to propel the mind of all mankind to seek the wisdom of Buddhahood. Its dwelling place is in the performance of the Bodhisattva vows, walking the Bodhisattva path by all who seek perfect enlightenment. So this is the gist of it. It's actually the sutta to train great beings, Bodhisattvas, to fulfill the vows, to liberate and teach all beings, to transmit this teaching to the world, to all of humanity and the world. So this sutta is a very unique sutta, Wuliang Yi Jing, and is the first chapter is virtue. We will go into virtue after we go through that text. We will go into the textbook proper. So this is the cover page of the book. So they have this bookshop called Jing Si Dharma Lineage up here. Collection. The essence of this infinite meaning sutta. They are the teachings on the adapted verses. They adopt the verses from the sutta. Then they share of the sutra of infinite meaning or innumerable meaning. So the author of this book is the Abbot of Ciji, Zhen Yan Fa Shi, Shi Zhen Yan. Okay, we turn to the next page. The essence of infinite meaning, the three treasure within all of us. So this one, we should start off with this one first. The three treasure within all of us, within each single living beings, we better use living being instead of person. There are three precious treasure. We call it the triple gem. You know what is a gemstone, right? The most precious of all the precious stone is called a gemstone. That's why it's called the triple gem. They are pure and undefiled, beyond all arising and ceasing. This is the unconditioned. The Buddha abides in everyone's heart. This is our compassion. So this is actually the analogy. But the deeper meaning I must explain to you. Here the Buddha means our Buddha nature, understand? Our original nature, our true nature, our oneness nature. But like the mianmu, original nature. Or source of all things, abides in everyone's heart. Yes, our heart, there is a gateway to link to that nature. Then in Dhamma term, because Sammasambuddha, Buddhas, they have the embodiment of wisdom and virtue, perfection of wisdom and virtue. But here the author used this word compassion, yeah? Which is also okay, because although it didn't completely give the full meaning of Sakyamuni Buddha, the Buddha nature, but that word compassion is enough, because to have true compassion, you must have wisdom and virtue. Otherwise, you cannot develop true compassion. Then the Dhamma abides in everyone's heart. So Dhamma is the teaching. This is wisdom. He said, this is our wisdom. Then the Sangha abides in everyone's heart. This is our discipline. But here, the meaning is not so appropriate or correct. I have to maybe highlight here a bit. You all make a note. The triple gem, when the Buddha talked about the Sangha, it is the enlightened disciple of the Buddha. It's not just your morality. Maybe you look at it from the different point of view. Let's say, once you become enlightened, yeah, even a sotapan, they cannot break their precept. So you will have your discipline in your heart. Yeah. But this is not something inherent in you. When you have delusion, this is not in everyone's heart. Then the Sangha means the embodiment of the wisdom that you have awakened to or realized. That's why they call it the enlightened disciples of the Buddha, the Aryan Sangha, not the ordinary Sangha, not anyone who wear the robe. This one, even if you are a lay disciple or follower of the Buddha's teaching, if you have awakened, you are also part of the Aryan Sangha, the enlightened disciple or devotee or followers of the Buddha. That everyone is fundamentally replete with compassion, wisdom, and self-discipline. So what she's trying to share with you is your nature, when it awakens, you will have the wisdom. With the wisdom, morality will be there, compassion will be there, virtue will be there. So this is the complete understanding of the three treasure. Actually, it's the triple gem. The mind is the Buddha. The mind, the Buddha, and all sentient beings are no different in their nature. This pure intrinsic nature is present in every one of us. As long as we can eliminate our habitual tendency, root out. As long as you can root out your habitual tendency. Habitual tendency means mechanical. You don't think one. You don't apply yoniso manasikara one or wisdom one. It has become habit. You just repeat it. Like mechanical, automatic, shoot out already. When you get angry, unhappy, selfish. And he said, we can return to this pure nature, which is our Buddha's nature. So this is a very important understanding, how to go back. You see, the mind, the Buddha, and all sentient beings are no different in their nature. It means each and every living beings, when you come, you have a gateway to connect to your nature. So before you realize your nature, you are not the Buddha yet, because you have a form in mind. And when you have delusion and avijja, you are a putujana. Putujana means non-enlightened being. And you are no different from any sentient beings. But once you realize your Buddha nature, that's why he said, the three are no different in their nature. Because that nature is within all sentient beings. And mind make adi. So when that mind sees, you realize the nature. So this pure intrinsic nature is present in everyone. As long as we can root out, change the word eliminate, to root out our habitual tendency, we can return to this pure nature, our Buddha nature. Here you understand the meaning is very deep. Root out your habitual tendency means ignorant, sakkayaditti, self-delusion. Means you have realized your true mind, your silent mind. And to that, you actually can stabilize it and penetrate your Buddha nature. Then you can actually realize this pure nature, which is your Buddha nature. That's the reason why when I ask you to meditate, relax and maintain awareness to stabilize this awareness nature. This awareness nature is your true mind, is your silent mind, meditative mind. This is the one that can allow you to realize the cessation, to realize your oneness nature, your Buddha nature. Your original nature. So hopefully all this can be understood. Then we go to the content or preface. This one. Preface, up there is preface. Just now, where's the preface? Preface. Okay. So just now the preface, we already gone through. But now I will read to you the wordings that the author actually specifically, I think they reproduce it out just now from Wikipedia. You actually saw me explain to you to penetrate this sutta of innumerable meaning or infinite meaning. You need to realize that profound emptiness, the unconditioned and within the conditioned world. If you cannot penetrate that, you cannot understand. So now, this section is similar. So according to the author, he said, all things are impermanent and still in nature and appearances. So it's similar, except the words are different. Both the nature of the Dhamma and the appearances of all phenomena are ultimately empty. So now you understand what empty is. Empty nature or existence. And still, your nature is stillness, tranquility. Because it's the unconditioned, beyond thought, beyond mind, no word, nothing. No word means no concept, no idea, no duality, no this, no that. So this section is very profound unless you have penetrated the teachings of emptiness or anatta nature. You cannot understand this section. So I will read to you again so that it's clearer. Both the nature of the Dhamma and the appearances of all phenomena are ultimately empty and still. Emptiness and stillness are just like this, beyond any arising and ceasing or ceasing. Our pure intrinsic nature is equal to that of the Buddha and that of all Dhamma. Fundamentally, they are all of one essence. That's why it's called the oneness nature. Also, they are the unconditioned, beyond arising and ceasing. Our thoughts, this one you must also listen. This one can give you a lot of understanding and wisdom you can penetrate. Our thoughts are intrinsically intangible and formless, empty and still with absolutely no substance. But because we sentient beings lack this understanding and view the reality, and views of reality, this understanding and view of reality, So our deluded thinking mind or mundane mind, huh, led us to give rise to greed, hatred, and delusion. And thus we continue to confusely replicate and become lost in our own imagined reality. That's why you grasp, you cling, and you hold, and you give meaning. We create obstacles for ourselves and remain attached to the superficial judgment we make regarding matter and principle, like life situation. Entangled by complication, we continue to develop conflict. So this one is another way of putting it. This is the author's way, but I find it a bit not smooth flowing, because the one we share with you one is very beautiful, very easy to understand, basing on the four noble truth, the first noble truth, reality, and all those things. Here he used thought. He said thought are intrinsically intangible and formless. You remember the four analogy of the mind aggregates. Feeling is like bubble. Yeah? Perception is like a mirage. The third one is what? Sankara is what? Like a banana stem. So finally you peel layer after layer after layer at the core of it, at the center of it. There is nothing else. That's why it's empty. That's why it's our thoughts are intrinsically intangible and formless, empty and still, with absolutely nothing. That's why sankara anicang, sankara dukkang, dhamma anatta. So that saying of the Buddha is very profound and describe clearly what sankara is. That's why you cannot cling on to sankara, grasp on to sankara, give meaning to sankara. The Buddha already make it very clear, all of sankara is impermanent, empty. They come and they go. Don't cling, don't grasp, don't give meaning. If you cling, you grasp, suffering will follow you. If you want things your way, which is not nature's way, which is not the reality, suchness, you suffer. That's why sabbe sankara anicang, sabbe sankara dukkang. Then sabbe anatta, sabbe dhamma anatta. All of the conditioned and the unconditioned, they are also anatta, non-self, not a permanent unchanging entity, and empty. So this understanding is deeper, the one that I share with you all, based on the Buddha's teaching. Otherwise, it's not easy. If I don't explain all this, I don't think you can follow. Well, these are like words. It's not a very well-structured thing. Okay, we continue. In any given time, space, and or relationship, we must always keep gratitude, respect, and love in our heart. So this is the author's way of teaching, right? But he didn't explain the bigger picture. He didn't connect the whole thing. So in any given time, space, and relationship means while you are going through life within the conditioned world, he said we must always keep what? Gratitude, respect, and love in our heart. The meaning is what? These are right thoughts. Understand? Thoughts that are free of the evil roots. That's why you hold on to this principle, you will be okay. Yeah. So not only gratitude, respect, and love, although these are good virtue, but you must also have wisdom, compassion, understanding, integrity, sincerity, respect, etc. Otherwise, you cannot perfect yourself. Because what is more important is wrong thought. What are wrong thoughts? Thought that has the evil roots of greed, hatred, and delusion. thought that condition, your fear, your worry, your anxiety, your sorrow, your lamentation, your insecurity, your misery, your selfishness, your emotional negativity, and etc. So when you understand this definition of wrong thought, and when you understand what constitutes evil, your wrong thought has an evil root that makes you evil, then you can develop the ability to avoid evil. Otherwise, you can't. So the deeper meaning is what I have taught you and what I have shared with you. Eh? Then the author continued. He said, then we will not discriminate nor get attached. So here, the meaning is not that clear, because he only teaches you gratitude, respect, and love. You will not discriminate means no duality, but it's not mentioned up there. Then you will not get attached. To do this, you need wisdom. Yeah, sometimes you may express your gratitude, your respect. Then after that, you attach to that person because there is great respect and gratitude towards that person. So attachment can still be there because you lack wisdom. Then she continued to say, will not take issue over things or allow our environment to contaminate us. This one comes about only when there is wisdom and understanding. We will not let any conflict shake our resolve. Being in harmony with everything. This one also need wisdom. That's why accord and flow. Being in harmony with everything. We will be at peace. So all this, you need the Dhamma that I share with you all. Especially those from the Heart Sutta. For you to actually have the understanding to be able to do all this that she mentioned. When we are truly at peace and our mind has become completely clear and tranquil, we can realize the state of emptiness and stillness. This is what meditation is all about, isn't it? So you go back. Oh, okay. So I read, you listen. Being in harmony with everything means you can accord and flow. We will be at peace, true or not? If there is no harmony, there will be conflict. That's why harmony is a sign of wisdom. You cannot accept things as they are. You lack wisdom because you want things your way, which is not Nietzsche's way. Then when we are truly at peace, means with wisdom, and our mind has become completely clear and tranquil, means the silent mind, no thought, just aware, tranquility, stillness. We can realize the state of emptiness and stillness. This is meditation, because the awareness nature is wisdom energy, pure energy. The vibration is different. It is beyond thought, beyond mind. That's why that one can see things as they are, can insight into phenomena, can awaken to the three universal characteristics of greed, hatred, and delusion. And that is the silent mind, the meditative mind. Meditation is to realize this, nothing else. So if I don't explain, I don't think you can understand or follow. So now you see the importance of meditation. Just aware, relax, maintain awareness to realize that true mind, that silent mind, the state of emptiness and stillness. Karmic cause and effect is a nature's law. Causes and conditions coming together are what form everything in the universe. So this is the Paticca Samuppada, the law of dependent origination. Or the dwelling. All things in the universe exist within empty space and are made up of the four elements. The causes and conditions of earth, water, fire, and air combine within empty space to manifest different appearances and manifestation. According to the law of cause and effect, all things arise, abide, change, and cease. Therefore, all things arise interdependently. Actually, it's also dependent originating. Eh? Like a dream, they have no reality. Just like what we went through, eh? Lai ye kong, qi ye kong. Na mo si zu he bi ku ku in between, eh? Wei kong liu lei. Then the Diamond Sutta also have, yi qie yu wei fa, zu mong huan pao yin, zu lu yi lu dian, yin zuo lu si guan. So, 一切有为法, everything is conditioned dhamma. They are dreamlike, illusion, like a bubble and shadow. There is no reality. Like a lightning flash. They are all not real. There is no reality. Dreamlike and have no reality. All existence takes place within emptiness. It is within emptiness or empty space that things converge and combine following the nature's order. The four elements makes up of all things. So though existence manifests, it is ultimately empty in nature. All things can exist together in emptiness without interfering with each other, as they are fundamentally of one essence. When the world is completely tranquil and harmonious, a state of emptiness and stillness manifests. So this is very true. Huh? True emptiness intrinsically contains wondrous existence. See, this is Heart Sutta, Zheng Kou Miao Yu. The Tathagata's awakened nature is hidden within all of us, where we have the Buddha nature. Tathagata is Sammasambuddha. When we can eliminate the affliction of our minds, means our suffering, we can be one with the universe, that's why the oneness nature. Then we return to a tranquil and still state that is in rhythm and harmony with all things, the oneness nature. When we remove all impurities and are left with only the essence, when we distill our pure wisdom, we awaken to the pure truth within all of us and work for the benefits of all beings, is becoming a bodhisattva, a great being. With the realization of our mind's empty and still nature, we can exercise the potential of wondrous existence. Then we can comprehend all Dhamma. Okay, we finish. Huh? Another paragraph to go, just nice, 10 o'clock. The nature of everything is empty and still. In emptiness and stillness, we can cultivate all teachings and perfection. See, the silent mind. Huh? And perfectly reflect all of the mind-right appearances of the world. From one, we can realize the infinite. That's why from one come infinity. Huh? And the one can penetrate the many, while the many do not obstruct the one. Mutually, there is no obstruction. By fully comprehending the one principle, we will be clear about the principle underlying all matter and things. By returning to our intrinsic nature, we can penetrate all truth of the universe. So this is the author sharing, which is quite good. Eh? So the other explanation about this principle of one is based on the one that I used to share with you all. One is all is one. And the meaning is very deep. From one comes infinity, means from a single thought of ignorance that originated. The first thought of ignorance. That's why Sammasambuddha Sakyamuni say incomprehensible is the beginning of the first thought of ignorance that conditioned one's to fall until now. They're too long. Unless you're a Sammasambuddha, you cannot comprehend. That's why he used the word inconceivable. It's the beginning of the first thought. So from your first thought, it condition, and make you what you are. And it develops the sophistication of form and mind until all this samsaric segmented life arise and pass away. So that is one of the way to explain from one come infinity. Then the other one is one is all is one. Even though each and every living being, we may be very insignificant. We thought without us, no different. The universe continue to exist. In Hokkien, they used to say, ulu bolu, cha bo zai. Means whether you exist or you don't exist, the world doesn't need you. But they are wrong. Because although our nature, some of you all may be quite insignificant, where you have not cultivated, you are not perfected, you don't have a nature that can cause things to arise and create new arising. But even though that relatively insignificant single form of mind or living beings, do you realize that without that being, the universe will not be what it is today? Because that being, the small fellow, insignificant, has evolved over the eons and eons and eons and eons of birth and death. Every segmented life he come, he also has his condition, and he is also subject to karma influenced by all these things. So because of all these beings summation, you are what you are. And because of you, the universe is what it is. That's why all these are dependent originating because of the aeons and aeons and aeons of birth and death. So that meaning is more deep and more meaningful. Yeah? Okay, we finish. Yeah? So we all should rejoice. Huh? This first chapter is very important. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Okay. Then after that, maybe we open up for meditation, reporting, or question. If you have any question, you can ask. Then we can also share whatever you want to understand, or any part which you want me to make clear, or what you can ask. Maybe this is a very new teaching and chapter for most people. I believe most of you are Theravada based. You all started with Theravada and not much Mahayana understanding. But because of my nature, I can share with you and teach you in a very systematic manner, easy to comprehend and understand manner. Because over the years, my nature has guided the Kayanmitas. And most of you can follow because you have reached the understanding to actually have the ability to comprehend. Amitabha.
Amitabha. thank you for nominating me.
Sadhu.
What shall I talk about? About this.
How you play this teaching? Wuliang Yijing.
Yeah. This teaching is very interesting because because it kind of like talk a little bit. I do not know about this sutra yet, but based on this first chapter, it links some of the Heart Sutta that you taught us.
Yes,
with this, and based on the threefold chapters that you mentioned, right?
Lotus Sutra, yeah.
Yeah, the Threefold Lotus Sutra, it says virtue and the proclamation of the teaching and the ten merits.
The three chapters.
Yeah. These are so essential.
The Threefold Lotus Sutra are three separate books. But the first book is the one that we are going through. Yeah. Maybe I ask my doctor to shine it on the whiteboard. No, no need. Put on the whiteboard. Can I see it? Oh, okay. Then she bring it out for you again. See? The Threefold Lotus Sutta,
Okay.
Ba Hua, San Bu Jing. You know Mandarin, isn't it? You know
no,
when
no,
they
no,
know.
I don't.
Oh,
I
you
don't
don't
know.
know when they know. No
No,
wonder
I
you.
don't. I
Okay,
don't. I
that
don't.
is okay.
No, I
Because
don't.
you don't know
Yes.
Mandarin, that's why not easy.
Yeah.
Don't worry, yeah. I go through with you again, Bocheng, because not only you, I think many people are new, so not easy to follow. The three follow the sutta in Mandarin is called Fa Hua San Bu Jing. That's why sometimes they call it the Fa Hua Jing. Yeah? Fa Hua San Bu Jing. So they got three books. The first book is the one we are sharing, Sutta of Infinite or Innumerable Meaning, Wu Liang Yi Jing. You can see it on the computer screen. Then within this book, there are three chapters, Virtue, Proclamation of the Teaching, and the Ten Merits. So just now I have explained to you the significance of all these three chapters. They are all linked to the professional wisdom and virtue to become Samasambuddha. And also is meant to transform and awaken great beings so that they can share this teaching with the world. They can actually fulfill their vow to liberate all beings and take them across. Then the second book is the Lotus Sutta, the wonderful Dhamma Lotus Sutta, Miao Fa Lian Hua Jing. Then the third book is a very unique meditation sutta by Samantara Bhadra Bodhisattva. This is Puxian Pusa, Puxian Jing. So these three are very, very profound and powerful Mahayana sutta that Mahayana is very proud of. Because from this sutta, you learn everything about the cultivation and the perfection you need to become a bodhisattva, finally ending up as Samasambuddha. And every of the teaching is very wonderful, very beautiful. That's why it's connected, like you say, to the Heart Sutta, to the other Diamond Sutta, and also later on the Surangama Sutta and all the other Mahayana famous sutta. So this is why this book is very unique. And I wanted to share this long time ago. Actually, Tuesday class requested for it. So I said, okay, after that book, The Path to Truth, then we will start this book. So now we have the condition. That's why I say the first lesson, all Kayamita should try to attend so that you can understand. Then go back, listen to this again, and look at the notes that my daughter has actually put out. You don't use the handphone. Handphone, I was told, too small, you cannot see. But put it on your laptop or computer, then you can magnify. That is very clear, then very easy to follow, because she got the ebook. And then she was able to copy my link, just now the WhatsApp link. Or you open up the WhatsApp link, it's also there. But without my explanation, you cannot understand. So you go through the recording, the video, the audio, then you look, study it again, listen to it, if possible, a few times, so that it becomes clear and you build up your faith, your saddha, your virya, and your sincerity to walk this way. Yeah, this is a very beautiful teaching. Okay, Bocheng, you can continue.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much for the summary again. Yes, so this is something new to me, but based on the first chapter of this Innumerable Meanings, the sutra that virtue itself.
Very important. Virtue is very important.
Yes. It's very important, and what you went through with us just now is talking about the oneness nature, the true mind.
Yeah.
Well, everything we learn in the Heart Sutra, isn't it?
Yeah. All connected. Yeah.
Because it's kind of connected teaching, to it. Yes.
Yes. When they start the teaching, it is the Samasambuddha talking to all the Mahasattva, the Bodhisattva. The whole assembly was full of Bodhisattva and Mahasattva. That's why they call it the Tua Po Sat. Mahasattva. They are not ordinary bodhisattva. They are Maha Bodhisattva. That's why all are great beings. So immediately when they start, they talk about stillness, the oneness, the source, and all those things. That's why not easy to understand. If you have not gone through Mahasattva with me, not easy. And the concept of emptiness. Yeah, you continue.
So I was kind of like surprised that they start off with this, you know, so deep. And luckily, we went through the Heart Sutra, and then we know all this, you know, before.
That's how you can follow.
Yes, so we can follow. Otherwise, we'll be like in compassion, you know, follow, you know. So interesting. I expect it will be coming more and more deep,
and more profound, and today my nature rejoice, because first time we have 20 over login connected.
Everyone is excited.
So this introduction into our this new book is very beautiful. Hopefully, more and more Kayamita can develop the understanding. Last time Mimi said when we start this one, let her know. But it's in the My Kayamita website. I hope she saw it. Maybe she's too busy or what, I don't know. She haven't logged in yet. I haven't seen her. Mimi Chang. Joyce, good friend.
we must remind her then.
Somebody can help let her know. I remember when I told them I was about to share this book later after I finished The Path to Purity. That time was before the MCO. She reminded me to let her know when I start this teaching.
Yes. So actually, this chapter also explains very clearly the nature, the awareness nature, you know.
Correct.
Yeah. So in your meditation, if you do correctly, you will get all this info. Yeah. I mean, this experience. Yes, the silent mind.
You can understand this, because you have gone through.
Yes, it's so beautiful. When I listen to it. So beautiful. Explain in your meditation, you experience it. Explain here. So it matches with what you experience, you know.
Correct.
So it's very
wonderful.
yes, very beautiful. It's like, somebody finally understand.
There is a lot of joy.
A lot of joy.
When you can develop the meditation until you go through all this, that's why when the teaching is being shared, there's a lot of joy, because you can confirm all this, that it is what that nature is, because you went through, you stabilize it, then your nature gateway open up. That's why you had all those good experiences. Then from now onward, you will continue to stabilize and evolve and develop the understanding. There are many, many more steps to go, but don't worry, you are already very beautiful. And you will continue to develop the stability of it and the understanding as you progress. Then you will become beautiful. My nature rejoice.
Sadhu. It's very beautiful. Thank you, Brother Teo.
Thank you.
For bringing up this teaching as well, and also that.
It's meant to be. That's right. It's meant to be. I realize all this teaching, I never plan, I never like want to share or teach, but the book just came. I happened to be at this Jingshi and Ciji, the bookshop there. I think it was last year or the previous year, could be 2 years ago. Then suddenly I saw this book. Then I remember I heard the recording of this Pure Land teaching. They always talk about these two sutta, very powerful, Pure Land Mahayana Sutta, Wu Liang Yi Jing and Wu Liang Shou Jing. Then when they recite the stanza inside these two teaching, my nature rejoiced because it was so beautiful. They always talk about 所知障, means knowledge is an obstruction. Every knowing is an obstruction. Then there is another one, 所知障, 烦恼障, yes, 烦恼障. The karmic obstruction when you have worry, when you have sorrow, lamentation, 烦恼, when you grieve, 烦恼障. So all these are karmic obstruction, and it triggers all suffering. So every knowing from the sankhara, from memory, is knowledge, not wisdom. That's why it becomes an obstruction. 所知障. Everything that you come to know, if it's not developed through wisdom, it becomes an entanglement, an obstruction to awakening. That's why I don't hold on to too much knowledge. Meditate, silence your mind to awaken and realize. And then when you insight into phenomena and awaken, it's not a thought process, it's not a knowledge, it's the silent mind that see things as they are without the interference of the brain, the views, the opinion, and the conditioning. It's the direct seeing, seeing things as they are, the direct knowledge and vision of the reality, jnana dasana. So all these are very beautiful understanding. So once again, thank you, for saying sadhu to you, and sadhu to David for nominating you. That's how the thing is meant to be. Yeah. Very good.
Sadhu.
Anything else you want to share or maybe speak on?
Want to say something about what you said, brother.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people like want to gather knowledge or to understand, read books.
Yeah.
So all this can be an obstruction during meditation. Yeah.
Correct. So, especially when they go and look for it in the meditation, then it becomes thought based. Knowledge based.
It's like a double-edged sword, isn't it?
Yeah, you know,
also cannot. You know, and you hold on to it, and you look for it in the meditation, become a problem, you know?
Yeah.
So it's
now
a double-edged sword.
Now you start to understand.
That's the
reason why in the early years, I used to share this. I say, when a person, actually it's from J. Krishnamurti, he said, the most dangerous person in the world is a person who say, I know. Oh, when I read that statement, my nature rejoiced. Oh, I say, this guy is so wise. Do you all understand the meaning of the most dangerous person in this world is the one who say, I know? Because the knowing comes from the thought. Knowing is knowledge. You cannot use that word, I know. It's I understand. Understanding is not a knowledge. Understanding is a wisdom. That's a right view, right understanding. They didn't say right knowing. Because who know? What know? The thought know. And what is there to know? There is nothing. It's only knowledge. Whereas the realization and the insight is an awakening. You awake. It's not a knowledge. That's why from the silent mind, it awaken. Awaken means the aha moment. All of a sudden, you understand. Because the nature inside awaken. Like Hui Ning. The moment he heard truth, trigger off. Awaken really. So that one is wisdom. That's why wisdom is not a knowledge, cannot be learned.
Yes, it's not like you analyze it and then get
you
answer to
analyze
it, you know.
And reason. That one pertains to sankhara, the mundane mind, thought based. This one is awareness based, the silent mind.
Yes, the awareness nature is different from the thought thought.
Yes, from the thinking mind, the mundane mind.
Yes.
Now you are very clear about that.
Yes. You have when there is no thinking at all. It's
no
just
thought, nothing,
awareness.
No mental hindrance, nothing. Very light, very peaceful.
Yes, very light. Very, very clear.
Yeah, no movement, nothing. Just aware. And correct. That is most beautiful. And very few people can be in that state. There is a free mind in pure awareness, experiencing the tranquility, the stillness, the silence. Just aware. Finish. No need to know. Why do you want to know? When you silent and observe, the wisdom arises. That's why it's a choiceless awareness of the truth, of the reality, of what is. So when you silently observe, just like you observe a child, then you understand why the child is like that. They are very cute and very innocent. So you observe your mundane mind. You observe how your form and mind actually stir, react, and get itself into trouble. How suffering comes to be the cause of its arising. Then the teaching becomes very clear, Sakkayaditya, where you saw it in the meditation. Then you start to understand all this mind state, emotion, fear, greed, hatred, anger, sorrow, they come and they go. They are impermanent. They are not intrinsic in you. That's why anger is not you. Fear is not you. Then that realization transforms you. Then you never say, I still got anger. That is not meditation. That is delusion. Because you can't see that anger is dependent, originating, condition arising. Before you get angry, you are without anger. Then where the anger arise? The anger was never intrinsic within our nature. Our nature is the unconditioned, empty, don't have all this. But anger is dependent originating, means dependent on certain thing it arise, and mainly ignorant, which is self-delusion, avijja, sakkayaditti. Then you realize, if that is the case, I can reverse it. Straighten my view and reverse it. Finish. Then with the wisdom, I don't need anything. I don't have to suppress, control, and yarn. No need. I just understand. Sankara anicang, sankara dukkang, dhamma anatta. Sabbe sankara anicang, sabbe sankara dukkang. This is wisdom. Yoniso manasikara. It will arise and prompt you when you have reflected, contemplated deep enough. All this understanding will surface from that nature. It just come up at the moment of sense experience. That's why you are so manasika.
Yes, very pure. This is so true, you know. Yes, I went through it in the past week. It doesn't move.
Your whole mind become very peaceful, very quiet.
You can accept
the reality of the mind. You can even have joy. You can even have compassion.
People think that you're a bit crazy already, you know.
That's why people who cannot understand, they may think it's crazy. But this is reality. Possible. It can be done by those who have gone through. That's why I share and teach, if you really follow, you become very different. You transform.
But what I'm saying is, if they don't understand you, they think that
they think
crazy.
You are cheating already.
How come this person wrong?
Yeah, when you got no thought one, they tell you, like one of my classmates tell me, he said, how can don't think one? Is it? You cannot don't think one, is it? We are a human being, creature of thought, we have to think, is it? If I don't think, how to live life, he said, how to do work, how to experience things and all things. That's why they don't know that there is another mind that can be aware, specific phenomenal awareness, spacious awareness, that silent mind, that nature which is so different. Unless you realize that, you never understand who are you, what are you. We are only that one which is beyond thought, beyond mind, can observe, understand and awaken. Nothing else can awaken you. thought-based meditation limited by the instrument of thought. How can you awaken? Knowledge is thought. So all this become very clear to those who really can develop the silent mind, the awareness nature to understand. Sadhu.
Yes. Sadhu. Thank you, Radio, for
Thank you.
Profound teaching.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, sadhu. So let us rejoice. Sadhu.
Radio.
Ah, yes. Ah, Ananda, yes.
I just want to inform that I just dropped a message asking Sister Mimi to just call you for more details for this date and classes.
Okay.
Can, I dropped a message to her WhatsApp already.
No problem. Okay. And also can ask her to listen to the recording. I think tomorrow it will come out. Once she listens to the recording, she will understand because she is also not bad, quite good. So thank you for transmitting the message. Susan is in, yeah. Yes, yeah, Sadhu.
Yeah, thank you for the introduction into this sutta.
Yeah.
It's something very, very new.
Yeah.
Need to give it time to follow and understand further.
Yeah, definitely. Well, it is something quite new to most of you all, unless you have some Mahayana background. Mm. Yeah. Otherwise, this sutta is already
new. I know that's the thing, but I have well, the Heart Sutta, yes.
Yeah.
You know, but that Heart Sutta in itself is already very comprehensive.
Yeah, very comprehensive and complete. Yeah. That's why without the Heart Sutta, you all cannot understand all these subsequent sutta, I tell you. The Heart Sutta is the basis. That's why Po Cheng rejoices, because from the Heart Sutta, she penetrates and she can understand what I share today. It's so beautiful. But this other Mahayana Sutta is for enlightened beings. They straight away go to the nature, the oneness. Even the author, he don't have time to explain. There is not easy to explain. Straight away go
there's
in.
There's one question, Brother Teo.
Yeah, okay.
Could you elaborate, perhaps, maybe not tonight, if it's already too late.
Yeah.
On the, just now you were saying about one for all and all for one.
Yeah.
You know?
One is all.
One is all and
all is one.
How does it
my daughter can explain
singularity.
I will explain that. Susan. You hold on. My daughter want to try to explain. You just give it a minute.
I suddenly recall something I heard from the Dalai Lama. He gave a very interesting analogy, how everyone is connected and everyone is interdependent in this existence. How one is all and all is one. So his example is you walk into a forest and then there are no birds. You automatically feel something is amiss. The birds might not affect you directly, but they are part of your world. The world is different when there are no birds in the jungle when you walk into it. Similarly, all of us, all the energy we generate, all the thoughts we have, everything we send out to the world makes up the world consciousness. It creates the world as we know it today. With any part of your life missing, you wouldn't be the same person you are today. With any experience missing, you wouldn't think the way you think today. So that's how we're all an amalgamation of each other's actions and reactions. Even with one screw loose, the world would not be the same. 911 may not have happened. It's that effect. Yeah, that's how I understand it.
That's the interdependence.
Yeah, they use that concept of interdependent. Interdependent means each and every phenomena in this universe, according to the Buddha, is they arise dependent originating. So dependent on all the other conditions, you are what you are. otherwise you cannot arise. Like the Buddha say, whatever that arise, there are causes and conditions. But these causes and conditions has already arisen. That's why it is the reality then. Like my daughter say, every organism, every living being, every phenomena, or every living thing, they play a role. They influence each other. The climate, the gravity, the planets, the totality of consciousness. Then also for your case, like let's say Susan, not only this life, you may have gone through birth and death for countless and countless eons of birth and death. But let's say take this life, if you don't arise this life, if your parents don't give birth to you and you don't exist until now, do you know the world will not be what it is now? Your children will not exist. Understand?
Yes.
Your husband may not be your husband. He may marry somebody else or what, we don't know. Then your whole family don't exist. And your children has his relationship with others. Do you understand? Then
yes.
Without you, they don't exist. And without you, they not only don't exist, their relationship with others that influence the world, the consciousness, all also don't exist. So this is a very simple way of explaining to you, one is all is one. We are not different. We are not apart from each other. That's why J. Krishnamurti is very good. He said, we are the summation of the totality. You understand this word, isn't it?
Yes.
Summation, like the planet consciousness, all the beings' consciousness, we sum them together, we become the collective consciousness. So if you are the summation of all this, for the world to change, what must happen? The individual must change. Do you understand?
Yes.
If the individual don't change, the totality, which is a summation, also won't change. Do you understand?
Yes.
That is the deep meaning of interdependent. That is the deep meaning of why one is all is one. Without you, the universe will not be what it is today. Without the universe condition, you will not be what you are today. Now you understand? Then the singularity is another concept. The singularity is a concept which is very deep. It's in the Mahayana Sutta. That's why they say from a single mote of dust, that nature exists, the oneness nature. From there, you can understand all things. Means you can go back to the source, the singularity, you will know everything. That's why you become the Sammasambuddha. Why? Because from the singularity it starts. The scientists also got this term. They call it the singularity, the beginning. No, the beginning. The Big Bang. The creation. When creation starts at the moment of Big Bang, then the expanding universe, from there, creation starts. So, from that singularity, the expanding universe expands. Then for you to understand, you must go back to the singularity. That's why that four stages of evolution, you remember in the Heart Sutta, the four circle. From the source, the oneness nature. The first one to come out is a pure awareness.
Yeah.
Then the mundane mind, then the phenomenal world of consciousness and form. That's how we come out, we create. So to return, we have to cease the external phenomenal world, return it to mind. Then mind return to the awareness nature. Then the awareness nature develop the wisdom and cease, you return to the source. That's how you realize the unconditioned Nibbana, the oneness nature. Then when you become Sammasambuddha, you return to the source, the singularity.
Yes.
Then from there you have all-knowing knowledge. Because of your perfection, your wisdom. But that wisdom and perfection doesn't make you special or magical on the side. Maybe special in its own sense that you are the wisest and the most virtuous. But he also need a vehicle and a to come, means the segmented life, the form and the mind. So that one is subject to decay, old age sickness. That's why that one cannot make him a superman. That's, even like, with the psychic everything. That one is subject to nature's evolution, subject to nature's decay process. That's why it goes the way of nature. It's of the nature to grow old, get sick and die. But that one is not him, he realized. That's why he frees his mind. He don't attach and cling and hold. Then he know there is another nature that has this perfection of wisdom, Sama, some Buddhahood's perfection, the Sambhogayakaya. So when he connect to the nature, to the source, he inherited that thing. And that one coming, he become the Dhammakaya, the Sama Sambuddha that teach the Dhamma. But that wisdom is extraordinary, yes. But that one cannot do magic, understand? So you have to understand its limitation. Like my nature, I can understand many, many things. I can teach people, share with beings and all those things. That I can teach you how to overcome your coming problem, all those things. Because I know the nature's law. I know the nature's law that governs life and existence, the secret of life. All that. But my form and mind is like any ordinary human being, except it's supported by the karmic nature, the spiritual nature, that makes it different. That's it. And because of affinity, I can share all this and let people understand. So hopefully that is clear to you, Susan.
Yeah.
Sadhu,
thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, for the good question. Yeah.